I'm with Mr. Bob Booker at the Beck Cultural Exchange Center. Mr. Booker, thank you so much for taking the time to talk with me. It's really an honor for me to be here. You've done it all. You were an Army veteran, civil rights champion, a state representative, city council member, historian, author, and just so many things. So please just tell us about Bob Booker.
Well, Mayor, I thank you for having me for this chat. I'm a native Knoxvillian. I really love my city. We've had our ups and downs, but I've tried to live elsewhere, but I've always come back home, and this is where I will always be. So this is my city and always will be.
What was it like growing up as a black man in Knoxville?
Even though segregation was there, I'm not sure it affected my psyche in any way as I was growing up. One of the reasons, I guess, is that we had teachers who had been through that school of hard knocks with racism and whatever, and they tried to make it as easy for us as they could. So, except for not being able to go to the Tennessee Theater, for example, or the Riviera, or being restricted to Chilawi Park only one day a year, I'm not sure I thought about racial segregation as such.
So yes, after high school, you went into the Army?
That's right. I joined the Army to get the GI Bill, and that way I could go to Knoxville College. I was student body president two times, and student government got in my blood.
Well, what made you become involved in the civil rights movement?
What made me become involved was Uncle Sam. I went to the Army at the age of 19. I had never been away from Knoxville. I had drunk out of separate water fountains. I had rode the back of the bus. I had suffered the other indignities of segregation without paying any attention. But when I went to the Army, I was free for the first time in my life. I could stay in any hotel, eat in any restaurant, see any movie I wanted to see, and just lived it up for 3 years. When I came back to Knoxville in May of 1957, I was back to square one because we were still segregated. When the sit-in movement started in Greensboro, North Carolina with the students at AMT College, I had become president of the student government at Knoxville College. And I said, gee, that's a great idea. We ought to be doing that in Knoxville. So we organized the students to have stand-ins at the downtown movie theaters, and we organized sit-ins at the downtown lunch counters. So that's how I got involved. I had tasted freedom in Europe for 3 years and got back to Knoxville, and that freedom was gone all over again.
I think something that's important to remember is when we look back at history and events and eras, we always think, this is how it turned out. And we forget that at the time it was an unknown. People like you were taking an enormous risk doing what you were doing.
It was very serious business. When I was arrested picketing at one of the downtown theaters, I was put in the wagon. I was being taken to jail, and the wagon driver said, I don't know what's wrong with you colored people. You have the Gym Theater there at the corner of Vine and Central. Why are you coming up here on Gay Street? It's the communists who are stirring this up, he said. And you're nothing but a communist dupe, as he took me on to jail. But I tried to inject a little levity wherever I could. For example, when the wagon driver was calling me a communist and all that kind of stuff, we were driving down Gay Street, and he spots a drunk. And he decides to put the man in the wagon. I said, hey, wait, you can't put that white man in here with me. He said, oh, we don't discriminate in here, buddy. And so you had to laugh with the silliness of it. And a lot of times it was indeed silly. One day we went to Rich's department store where they had this lunch counter. Blacks weren't allowed. So there was an empty seat between two white fellas, and I plopped down. Finally, he said to me, would you pass me the salt? And I said, sure. He salted his burger and bit into it. And I said, excuse me, mister, but do you object to sitting beside Negroes? He said, I sure as hell do, buddy, and got up and moved. But he hadn't thought about that. So another time, a young lady and I went to a lunch counter and it closed down. And the waitresses were in the back room. So an older white woman came in and she looked at her watch. She said, "Where is everybody?" And my friend said, "The lunch counter is closed." She said, "Why? It's noon." And my friend said, "Because Negroes are in here." The white woman said, "Where? I don't see any." I mean, we were light-skinned, but we were not that white.
And I find it interesting, too, often in our interpersonal relationships with other people, one-on-one, everything's fine. But when we look at ourselves as a group, and then we have these stereotypes and these different ideas that come to mind, just like you said, that's where we get into trouble. Do you kind of see it that way too, especially at that time? You know, I'm sure you had, you know, some white folks who were friends or knew you personally, but then they would look at like black people and it would be a different attitude.
Oh, I think that happens quite often. You know, there are people who look at the race as a whole and say, "Well, I really don't want to associate with those people. Those people shouldn't live in my neighborhood. I don't want to know if I need to work beside a person like that." But when they get to know a black person individually and knows he's just as good as they are, they like to talk sports or they like to watch Westerns or whatever. Well, hey, Joe is just like me. He's not like those other people. But those other people are just like him and Joe.
Well, I think when you look at the civil rights movement and the nonviolent philosophy of Dr. King, in the end, that was really what it was, wasn't it? Was showing people how awful the segregation, how awful racism was, and through mass media, bringing it into people's living rooms and having it, you know, having people confront that and realize if you're a decent human being, this is not how we should treat other people.
And I like to say that about white people in Knoxville, because they would watch the 6 o'clock news and see how people were hosed in Birmingham or had dogs sicked on them while they were protesting. And they would say how terrible that is, the way they're treating those colored people. But whites here in Knoxville had not realized that I couldn't go to a corner drugstore and drink a milkshake or eat a banana split. But once these protests started in Knoxville, they said, "Aha, we had that same problem here. We don't have the dogs and the fire hoses, but we're still denying people rights to public accommodation." And they began to turn in their charge plates to department stores. Some of them even joined the picket lines. So that's one of the reasons it was easier in Knoxville to break down segregation, because there were a lot of sympathetic whites. We were very much in the minority here in Knoxville, and I always have to give those props to people who joined us in that effort.
So now we move ahead to 2020, and unfortunately the country once again is embroiled with racial tension. What do you see as the future for race relations in America? How do you see us coming together? Because we're going to have to come together and confront and solve these issues.
Well, let me relate an experience that happened to me last week. I write this column for the New Sentinel, and I had this older white man call me, and he said, "Mr. Booker, I love reading your column. Would you please write something and tell the UT Lady Vols to stop taking a knee?" I said, "Well, you know, my response is not going to be what you like. You might not like me after I say this to you. But they have the right to take that knee. They are protesting what's happening to them and people they know. They know people who, when they get into their cars, are stopped by police officers for no reason other than driving while black. They are going to be people who know famous basketball players and football players who can buy any kind of vehicle they want, but yet the cops are going to pull them over because they're suspected drug dealers driving these fine cars. They have a right to protest that, to say, in the future, we're trying to get away from this. Won't you people please listen to us, that we're not being treated by police?" young people really have caught on, just like we did with the sit-in movement, to say, our future is not bright if this stuff keeps happening. And I'm hoping that one day the people who control things will say, look, enough is enough. And I think that raid on Washington has awakened a lot of people. You know, you just don't attack the Capitol. We believe in peaceful protesting. You should carry picket signs. You should yell and scream, but you don't have to destroy property, especially government property that you are paying for. So I'm hoping that people will look at all of these things, at what happened in Washington, the people who are taking a knee, and the killings that have gone on recently. I hope that will make it better. At least I'm optimistic that it will.
I certainly hope so. I think the most important thing is we relate to each other as human beings first.
Yes.
And everything else second, and realize that there's a baseline of how we should treat each other. And throughout history, humanity has certainly not always lived up to that baseline. And maybe this can be the generation that does.
Well, I hope so. We always have to be optimistic and think positively about it. But who knows?
Tell us about your journey into state government. You were the first black state representative elected from Knoxville, I believe, in 1966. Is that correct?
Yes, I was elected in 1966, and I won three terms. And I guess I got the big head, and there was a mayor's race coming up in 71. So I said, I think I'll run for mayor of Knoxville. And of course, I did get in the race, and I think I did fairly well. So Kyle Testman, who was elected, appointed me his administrative assistant. And I became the first black person in Knoxville to serve in administrative position in city government. And after 3 years, I left Knoxville and became market development manager for Stroh's Beer in Detroit. And after 3 years there, I got tired of that. And I said, I've got to go back to Knoxville where I belong.
Tell us about your involvement with the Beck Center.
When I came back from Detroit, the people who operated the Board of Trustees at Beck said, we'd like to consider you as director of the Beck Center. And I said, I think I'd like that. And so I came to work here, knew nothing about black history, especially blacks in Knoxville. So I began to do a lot of research, and I kind of became the local expert on black history because I read every newspaper I could find. I read every book I could find, read city council minutes. I went any place I could find information on the black community and put it all together in my head and began to make a program out of it for the Beck Center.
Along the way, you've written how many books?
I've published five. And they're all local history books. Our history is just replete with interesting stories and fantastic facts.
Mr. Booker, I very much appreciate your time. This has been amazing. I could actually talk with you all day, but thank you very much for your contributions to Knoxville. Just appreciate it.
It's good to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
Thank you, sir.